Buenos días a todos y a todas y bienvenidos a este foro internacional que con motivo de su 10º aniversario Casa Árabe ha organizado con el objetivo de analizar las transformaciones del mundo árabe durante esta última década. Voy a ser muy breve porque, como explicaré después, el profesor Filiu ha tenido la enorme generosidad de prestarse a dar la lección inaugural y, como creo que es mucho más importante lo que diga él que lo que diga yo, voy a ser lo más breve posible. El objetivo de este foro es, como decía, analizar las transformaciones del mundo árabe en la última década. Hemos reunido a 17 expertos de distintos orígenes y experiencias, pensadores y profesionales de ámbitos diversos para reflexionar sobre las sociedades árabes de forma multidisciplinar y complementaria. No podemos evitar pensar que dichas transformaciones han estado marcadas por las revueltas que conformaron la llamada Primavera Árabe iniciada a finales de 2010 en Túnez. Sin embargo, ya desde unos años antes, el mundo árabe presentaba síntomas a nivel político, económico y social que allanaron el camino a estos cambios profundos que trataremos durante el día de hoy y de mañana. La Primavera Árabe es para muchos el despertar definitivo de los pueblos árabes y especialmente de una juventud que alzaba la voz para reclamar un futuro menos desesperanzador. Para otros se trata de una experiencia idealizada cuyos resultados, lejos de conseguir un cambio, han perpetuado ese viejo sistema al que hacían frente. Para comprender por qué las protestas han tenido consecuencias y derivas diversas en unos países y otros, es necesario examinar las tendencias regionales y tomar en consideración una gran variedad de factores que trataremos durante estos días. La complejidad de estos procesos y las especificidades de cada país hacen que, incluso pasados varios años, sea difícil establecer una valoración concreta sobre el verdadero impacto de estas revoluciones a largo plazo. Para entender la región, hemos pensado en hacer esta reflexión desde tres niveles distintos: el individuo y su desarrollo humano, la situación actual del Estado-Nación y el sistema regional e internacional en el que tienen lugar dichas transformaciones. Me voy a quedar aquí porque, como decía, creo que es mucho más importante conceder más tiempo a nuestro ponente que a mí. Suministraremos durante estos días a todos aquellos que estén interesados información sobre la Casa Árabe como institución, pero, como digo, ahora voy a pasar la palabra a Jean-Pierre Filiu y les deseo a todos ustedes unas jornadas muy provechosas en las que el análisis y el debate sirvan como colofón a las ponencias de los expertos que nos acompañan. Como ya he dicho reiteradamente, para abrir las jornadas contamos con un experto de excepción, Jean-Pierre Filiu, que ha tenido la magnanimidad de dejar por unas horas la Francia postelectoral para acompañarnos hoy. Le agradecemos profunda y sinceramente esa generosidad. Muchas gracias también a todos ustedes por su presencia. Jean-Pierre Filiu tiene la palabra. Ah, perdón, una cuestión de orden. Hay un error en el programa. Se dice que la primera mesa va a empezar a las 11:30, pero será a las 11. Y para aquellos que quieran tuitear, hay un hashtag que es Casa Árabe Debates. Gracias. Perdón.
Le agradezco muchísimo esas palabras, Pedro Villena, y su invitación aquí para el 10º aniversario de la Casa Árabe. Para mí no solo es un honor académico, pero también es una emoción sincera, porque hace 10 años, cuando la Casa Árabe ya no estaba en este magnífico monumento. Yo tuve el privilegio de dar una charla en el Círculo de Bellas Artes a propósito de Al-Qaeda en contra del Islam. Al-Qaeda en contra del Islam, hace 10 años. Ahora es imposible oír más de 5 minutos a propósito del mundo árabe y del yihadismo sin oír Estado Islámico, 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 Islámico. Es decir, que la distinción que pudiéramos hacer en estos tiempos ya es muy complicada, muy compleja y sigue bajo nuestro papel y deber de académicos. Emoción también, porque la emoción de Atocha, y la emoción de Atocha sigue. En el bosque de los ausentes, aquí en el retiro, y en esta herida profunda del 11 de septiembre europeo, que fue el 11M. Con toda solidaridad de Europa y de Francia al pueblo español que salió de esta crisis con honor y fuerza. Y al mismo tiempo, el señor director fue tan amable de recordar que ayer había elecciones en Francia. Nosotros, franceses, bueno, la humildad no es nuestra tendencia natural, pero hemos pasado ayer, bueno, por elecciones casi parecidas a las egipcias de mayo 2012. Eso es decir que nosotros en Europa somos tan desarrollados, tan avanzados. No, era lo mismo. La segunda vuelta va a ser menos pésima que la de Egipto, pero hemos sentido el viento del cañón. Y eso para decir que lo que ocurre en el mundo árabe no se queda en el mundo árabe. Son evoluciones que pueden tomar lo más íntimo del proceso democrático en Europa también. Yo hablaré hoy día, ahora después de estas palabras durante 35 minutos, de revolución y contrarrevolución para que tengamos 10 minutos de intercambio y a las 10 y media, como Cendrillon, me debo huir antes de sumar. Yo hablo de revolución y sigo hablando de revolución porque lo que ocurrió fue una ola revolucionaria contra el Nizam, y los arabistas saben que el Nizam es una noción polisémica, la de régimen y la de sistema. Y cuando se decía Eshab Yuri Discot Nizam, se decía no solo que Mubarak o Ben Ali o no sé qué tiene que irse, pero que también el sistema corrupto que nutría esas dictaduras, debía derrumbarse, no derrumbarse así porque había decidido que ya estaba tiempo para él por derrumbarse, pero porque el pueblo quería derrumbarle. Iskot. Not sukut, iskot. Es activo. Yo nunca he pensado que hubiera revoluciones en todas partes, pero
there could be revolutions all over, but I think that essentially it's a revolutionary movement, and the I think the key dynamics in the Arab world are still revolutionary.
There
are many explanations that have been given to explain that revolutionary wave.
Acontecer mucho antes por las contradicciones dentro
this
de
could have happened a long time before because of the contradictions in the systems, in the countries, such obscene contradictions.
Hubo la intervención de 2003
but
de América en Irak.
There was the US intervention in 2003 in Iraq. That took place, and literally,
regímenes fallecidos,
5 or 10 more years
fallidos,
to those failed regimes. It gave them failed regimes. Yes, of course, they're failed regimes.
Pero La intervención americana,
it gave them
por su torpeza,
that leeway. The American intervention, because it was clumsy, it was wrongly done, it was almost a repeat post-colonial attempt, it gave them a new lease of life. They were able to survive for another 5 or 10 years under the,
lo poco que se queda de política under the watchword, al nivel
which
en
is
anti-terrorismo.
Of anti-terrorism, there, which is, there isn't much else. That we can say of politics in these countries,
con Obama,
anti-terrorism,
Trump,
with George W. Bush, Obama, Trump, and of course with Putin.
Y hubo también el nivel del there petróleo.
There's also the oil
soy
question. I'm a historian myself, and we as historians are pretty good at
pero si el petróleo
for seeing the past.
Estado a $40,
but if the oil price in 2011 had been
hubiera sido un tsunami. Pero con el petróleo,
a high price,
Arabia, por supuesto,
then it would have been different. But with oil in Saudi Arabia,
aquí,
and the expert in, the,
pero
in this
en
matter
Algeria,
is here today.
Por lo tanto, no hubiéramos tenido la posibilidad de inyectar.
We wouldn't have had
somas colosales.
The opportunity to
para no mover
inject
ni un dedito.
Huge sums
para aplacar, la
a money
social,
to be able to
política,
to pacify and to dampen down the political wrath.
Petrolífera.
It's all about the,
hay una explicación entre otras,
the oil wealth and generosity there. There are other explanations
utilizo más porque soy historiador,
that I tend
soy
to give more than these
cuento,
ones because I'm a historian, I'm a terrible economist, I've always been bad at economics.
Y con eso respeto aún más economistas,
and that makes me respect
economists
even more. And that is demographics, demographic transitions, the fact that, and the director has already mentioned, young people, the fact that in 40 years, rather, demographics changed around in Arab countries. It took 2 centuries for this to happen in Europe. It was a fast-moving, drastic changeover with a radical shift in the family model and the relationship between citizens and the paternal family model in and out. The youth bulge is the word used by the experts in demographics, and I call it the Shabab effect. It's a pyramid, isn't it? But it's not necessarily teenagers. It's about young adults aged between 18 and 35.
Nosotros conocemos íntimamente
we
movimientos de de
are very familiar with protest movements,
protesta. Sabemos que la mayoría de los activistas,
and we know that
son jóvenes,
the majority of
madres
activists
no son
are,
estudiantes del
are young mothers and fathers.
No
they are no longer the typical 1968 student protesters with no family responsibilities at all. As others have done before
me,
I use the word spring, the Arab spring, but
discutible.
I think it is slightly questionable.
La gente que la
firstly, because the people who have used this word
la primavera de 2011
back in spring 2011,
una primavera y hasta.
What they wanted was a spring,
Arabes,
full stop.
Un poco,
they wanted the
libertad,
Arabs
pero
to play and
no,
enjoy their freedom for a while, and then for it all to come to an end, like the season, spring, and then it's over.
Sobre todo que era cierto que
but all because it was true to say that in the very first elections, the Islamists were always going to win the elections because they were the most organized party, with the most consolidated networks, and they had the tactical advantage during that very first election to be at the same time the Party of Order and the Party of Change, the Party of Order from the moral standpoint, and the Party of Change for those people who were saying this system is corrupt. The Islamists will pull it apart and we will get above that system. And I was sure that we were going to have an Islamist autumn. And then, what next? Spring, autumn, what next? What came after that? Historians, Hebrew historians do not believe in a cyclical view on history.
Utilizando la palabra
reading the card in that way,
ya se matizaba de negativo el otoño islamista.
So in a way, using the word spring, we were already putting a negative slant on the Islamist autumn, weren't we?
Ya
but whatever happened, it was something that was going to be after,
post.
And when this happened, most Europeans were sure that it had all ended in failure. And they were not ready or willing to provide the support, the funding, the cooperation that were needed for this massive step forward that was the fall of the wall of fear in the Arab world that could only be compared to the Berlin Wall coming down in Europe in 1989. So as we've seen, Algeria and Saudi Arabia drowned the protests as they dampened them down with oil money,
directamente en
and in the Emirates also
la mayor
directly got involved in Bahrain to put out the fire of the biggest protest
Marruecos
in the Gulf states that we had seen before. Morocco was the cleverest country of them all. After the 20th of February movement, or the 9th of March movement for that monarchy or that monarchist constitution, following that, the parties have not actually taken full advantage of the powers they had in the constitution. It's more about self-censorship, self-restraint in the Moroccan political scenario than an imposition from above for the monarchy. So it was a successful move, the only one really, because when people protested, there was an immediate reaction, totally different to what happened with Mohamed Bouzizi in Tunisia. When the revolution started, little by little, in Morocco it was different. It went straight up to the king, the palace level, and there was an immediate reaction against the local leaders, and the protest was put down. Jordan, also clever, but in Jordan they've been clever enough to do nothing for years now. Palestine divided, a movement.
Shabjurid is Katanizab, Shabjurid in hell in his hand. El pueblo quiere el final de la división entre Gaza.
Wanted the end of the division between Gaza and the West Bank, but
arreglado.
But they was already sorted out. In Lebanon, the problem was that Nizam.
Centenares de personas, no es un Mubarak, no es.
There were hundreds of people, not just Mubarak, but so many interests, so many families, so many confessions. So they tried to do something at a citizen level, just as in Iraq. Just as in Kurdistan. In other words, it wasn't just an Arab Spring, you know. but the nature of power, it was spread out, it was scattered, it wasn't clearly defined. It meant that the protest couldn't be against a person, Ben Ali. They couldn't focus on a target like they did when they focused on Mubarak. So there were five movements here that have carried on. Tunisia, where everything started, Egypt, Libya, Yemen, and Syria. I'm going to very quickly describe them. Tunisia, revolution and transition. Libya, revolution without a transition.
Egypt,
a revolution through coup d'etat, and twice over.
Yemen, transition
that was not accomplished. And Syria, counter-revolution and liquidation.
Tunis, voto
Tunisia.
Poco, porque la idea es de que cuando se
Tunisia.
Vota mucho, se vota bien.
The voting that was very little voting. The little voting you tend to vote well. It's
in Iraq, botan
it's like think tanks. Look at in Iran they vote every 6 months. Look at the state of the country. Very little voting in Tunisia. Just once.
En los tres años después de la caída de Ben Ali.
Over the 3 years since the fall of Ben Ali. But the voting was good. I'm not saying that the outcome was positive. It was, but it was a clear vote for a clear transition, a clear change. There was a vote for a constitutional assembly given a mandate to draft the constitution for a second republic. And it was done, not in the mandate year, but it was done. And it's very important because I myself am from a country where we have quite a murky referendum past. It was not put to a vote in a referendum. No, it was a constitution that was a mandate to an assembly to draft that. And the vote was to be taken on every single article. And it was to be the agreement to rebuild the Second Republic, the foundations of the Second Republic, and in that constitutional assembly.
Conjunto.
There was work done jointly between nationalists and Islamists, and I have often written about the renaissance of the Arab world and how that can really only reach its full potential when nationalists and Islamists are working side by side. That doesn't mean to say that they have to overcome their differences and eliminate, but they have to work together.
Revolutionaries
want to fight each other. And if there is to be that war, there's so much the better for Nizam, for revolution. Things were not easy in Tunisia. There were tensions, there were accusations, political crimes committed, strikes.
But
Tunisia had three strategic advantages. One, it had no oil. And that is a blessing. Because if you have no oil, you have to negotiate because you will have nothing coming free from the skies or from the earth. So you will need to reach an agreement to get anywhere. The second advantage was the fact that Tunisia was a police state, not a military state, a police state.
Y que entonces la policía podía seguir mezclando con la política, pero no había posibilidad de tener los tanques.
Be mixed up with politics, but there was no way that you would end up with tanks at the door of the parliament. You would never get someone like Tejero bursting into parliament here in Spain. The third advantage was the UGTT, the General Tunisian Workers Union. They're a little French in the way they are.
They,
Yo les decía, if you live in Tunisia or France, so the world is a bit depressed. There is things that are terrible.
Hola, hombre. ¿Cuántos miembros tenéis?
But they used to say, and I used to say, how many members we have? Oh, we only have 800 million. 800 million
en un país
members
de un poco más de 10,
in a country with.
Pero sabéis que todos los sindicatos de Europa van a venir como a Fátima.
Do you know that all of the European trade unions are going to come on a pilgrimage to see this
this miracle?
You have doubled the number of members since the revolution. I said to them, and you're still depressed.
Y saben que la UGTT
so there is a tremendous
parte del premio Nobel
potential
de la Paz
and strength. You know that the UGTT
los,
were part of the Nobel Prize
y en la base de esta constitución,
for the transition in Tunisia. And there were legislative
en una base
and presidential
de Segunda República. No
elections, but it was all about the Second Republic. I don't want to talk about what happened after that, Bajbouj.
Shirase,
etc., etc.
Hay el modelo bueno, de mirror inverso, que es revolución sin transición en Libia, con
la revolución en Benghazi,
with the revolution in Benghazi
OTAN,
and the support of the NATO,
OTAN,
NATO and NATO's campaign
régimen,
against
pero,
the regime,
pero,
but
nunca hay que olvidar
we must
que
never
fue
forget
el pueblo libio
that it was the Libyan people who liberated themselves.
Y en Tripoli
and in Tripoli,
a su rumbo
they did so in their own way,
estupefacción del
to the great
Estado
surprise
mayor,
of, the,
de la OTAN.
Of NATO.
Quedaba Sirte,
there was
Sirte,
which was the cradle of Gaddafi, and then there was Misrata, where there were the greatest forces of the revolutionary groups, and they put an end to the dictator and the regime, but in such a way that it was not in a just manner, in a post-revolutionary, post-dictatorship manner. And it left room for the people supporting Gaddafi and those people who were affected by the vengeance, revenge of Misrata. They agreed to let the Daesh in. The jihadists in. There were first elections in June of 2012, and it was early days, far too early, under the pressure of NATO, because there's no good transition without elections. I don't accept that. There are very good this does happen without elections on some occasions, but that's another matter. And there was a general national congress or conference that was held, but it was elected, and it was unable to create a constitution. And so, therefore, under different pressures, especially on behalf of General Haftar from Tobruk, with the support of Cairo, and galvanized by the example of Sisi in Egypt, an attempt was made to imitate Sisi even in his body language. And therefore, there was a reaction and new elections were held. And the worst thing that could happen was that there were two parliaments, one in Tobruk, one in Tripoli, in Tobruk in June of 2014, and then a division of the country into two parties. And there was. There were people from the West. Think tank that supported supported them, and we couldn't say that the militias
de Misrata
from Misrata were more Islamist or less less so. But you know that the situation went from bad to worse, and now not only are there two, but there are three governments with a national union government under
el apoyo de las Naciones
Unidas, the support
y en vez
of the United Nations, and without instead of seeing a dynamic
gobierno,
of adhesion in this government, we've seen greater
todo,
division, in particular because Haftar and Egypt,
Argelia,
and quite possibly Algeria,
obvio,
but probably in a more obvious fashion,
constantemente
have constantly paralyzed and have sabotaged against that transition.
Revolution golpista,
the coup d'état revolution on behalf of the generals in Egypt, and first against Mubarak to save the regime in February of 2011, and then after an alliance with the Muslim Brotherhood in order to squash the young people's uprising in the streets of Cairo.
De un modo de sabotaje entre junio
they sabotaged 2012 and between June of 2012 and June 2013 against the first and until now only elected president in a democratic manner in Egypt up until the second coup d'etat in the summer of 2013 with the promise of holding parliamentary elections before the presidential elections. And the presidential elections were held in May of 2014 and parliamentary elections in the autumn of 2015. I must admit something myself, especially with regards to our friends in Egypt, and that is that I don't understand a thing about the electoral system in Egypt, nothing at all. But I think that it's been designed in that fashion for that reason, so that people cannot understand how those results are achieved, with what legitimacy and what the true weighting is of a member of parliament. In any case, they have no weighting at all. And that transition or non-transition against the revolutionary coup was very closely linked to remaining in the center of the constitutional device of the Constitutional Court, which had come from the times of Mubarak. Mubarak had appointed it in order to facilitate the hereditary succession between Hosni and Gabar. I don't know any revolutions that maintain a high court from the previous regime during the revolutionary period that followed it. And that court has totally paralyzed a decent transition process. And we've been the laughing stock. We've had three constitutions, all of them approved by referendum. In 2011, 2012, and 2013, they said the contrary, i.e., that not only was the repression, but that there was
a
destruction of the constitutional legitimacy on behalf of the institutions that hoped to defend that constitution. In Yemen, it was an unaccomplished transition that took place. There was a trend for a hereditary transition with Ali Abdali Saleh, the head of Yemen in the north of Yemen from 1978 and unified Yemen from 1990, to transfer power to his son Ahmed of the Republican Guard, and his nephew Ammar from the Special Forces. However, as happened in Libya, and without the same consequences arising, there was dissidence within the army between the forces
Ahmed
Ammar and Jaber al-Samer, of course, and also
علي محسن الأحمر
جيالي نصر أحمر
la brigada, la
from the 1st Brigade, the FIRCA.
Entonces,
and therefore, it was impossible for Ayub al-Saleh to carry out what we then saw happen in Syria, total repression with a unified army under his mandate. After several events, there was a transition, but it was never completed under the vice president, who then became president,
Hadi. Pero, esa transición,
but that transition did conserve the privileges and immunity and the fortunes and the political and military positions of the Sahar clan. They continued to be in the center of power where they could begin a subversion in a systematic manner, first with the jihadists and then later with the Houthis, the guerrilla force from the north of Yemen, and they could have never have occupied Sana'a if they had not had the force and the weapons and the contacts from the Saler within Sana'a and within other bases. Ali al-Yasaber could have been happy with just Sana'a, but dictators are people who tend to have bigger eyes than their stomachs. I'm not sure if that saying exists. They eat through their eyes almost, they're greedy.
And
so he took Aden as well and expelled Adi. And that was what unleashed the direct intervention of Saudi Arabia and the Emirates with the destruction,
implacable
destruction that took place from that time on in Yemen.
And
the serious possibility of there being an attack from Arabia, Iraq against the Hujaida in Yemen, and this would then add further human disasters to those that already existed. And finally, we had the counter-revolution for the settlement in Syria, where versus a when faced with
a
peaceful protest, the dictator accused it of being a terrorist protest, and there had been jihadist movements right dating back from the guerrilla times in Iraq, and so between the growth of that jihadism on the one hand and the militarized provocation on the other hand, this meant that the revolutionary dynamic of the citizens was defeated. And armed the weapons won over the Arab Spring in 2012. So in the summer of 2012, there was the Battle of the Two Capitals, i.e. the guerrilla in Damascus and Aleppo in 2003. Daesh was formally created in the city of Raqqa, which then was taken from the revolutionary forces the month before. So there is a debate that took place. Where will we set up our caliphate? In Mosul or in Aleppo? Aleppo is the privileged solution because it is a way of making Daesh more international, more open to cosmopolitan recruitment, in particular in Europe and Central Asia. And Aleppo meant further expansion and opening up. And Mosul in the, was more like a dead end street. But the possibility of having Aleppo meant that the Syrian revolutionaries went against this and expelled Daesh from Aleppo and from the province of Glebe in January 2014. And for this reason, it was Mosul, after a battle of several days, that was announced as the caliphate. But instead of taking into account that defeat that took place in Aleppo, quite the contrary, the regime started a campaign against Aleppo and not only tried to destroy a military threat, which wasn't really that much of a threat, but rather to destroy an alternative in Syria to the Syrian regime. And therefore, the destruction of bakeries and accommodation and schools are no exception, but rather they're part of a systematic plan in order to avoid an alternative to Assad in his own territory. Now, despite those campaigns, the weakness of the regime that had already forced Iran and its allies from Hezbollah, Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan from intervening directly had so many problems that Russia had to intervene directly as well in September of 2015. You know that 1 year later they brought about the total fall of eastern Aleppo. But we can see also that one cannot fix anything in Geneva or in Astana. What I'm proposing, and have been doing so for the last 3 years, are local ceasefires, but to make them not international. Totally the contrary of what NATO, Iran, and Qatar are preparing or proposing. Because Syrians from different parties can no longer survive this systematic destruction of their country, and the occupation of their country, an occupation which is far greater in governmental fields than in the jihadist networks. I will finish off using or resorting to some words of hope. Tunisia is a vulnerable exception, and it will continue to be vulnerable if it continues to be an exception. We need a second Tunisia in order to save Tunisia. The counter-revolution is quite fierce in Syria and Egypt with the regimes in power, and in Libya and Yemen there's a field of a civil war. But there's the taking of power of the repression services, the pro-Mubarak groups, and they are not the security forces, they are insecurity forces throughout the region. If you look to see what's happening in the Gaza Strip, the head of the military group and the political leaders. And so this process is the result of a counter-revolution, a fierce counter-revolution at a regional level. But at the same time, those regimes don't only bring about a historic failure. They had promised less freedoms, a lot more repression, but in exchange, stability and security. But where is that stability in Syria when half of the population had to flee? Where is that stability now in Egypt after the double attack against the churches over Easter. In order to find a historic precedent in Syria, we would have, after so much violence, we'd have to go back to Tamerlan in 1400. It's not the restoration of an authoritarian regime, it's going back to the darkest times in history of the Arab world. In order to go back to a comparable level of violence in Egypt, we'd have to go back to the times of Bonaparte and the famous events that took place here in Madrid. The Mamelukes, the Nizam regimes and dictators are unable to guarantee authoritarian security, which is the main promise that the paternalist agreement vouches for. And in the meantime, the social challenges and generational challenges open because of a generation of ex-revolutionary and post-revolutionary, all revolutionary people who have survived, and they have learned a great deal. I'd like to conclude with a great deal of emotion, because we're here with a public, that is an audience that's very interested in the Arab world, from a citizen or academic world, and I want to talk about the case of Giulio Regim. He's a 28-year student who disappeared on the 25th of January of 2016, the anniversary of the Egyptian Revolution. He was found having been badly tortured a couple of days later. Cairo's response to the legitimate claims on behalf of the Italian authorities and Regini's family have not responded to the minimum request for justice. Justice for Giulio. Thank you very much to all of you.